by Jonathan Schreiber here for seconds out, joined today by WBA bantamweight world champion Jamie McDonnell ahead of this fight on Saturday against Shaqon. First of all, Jamie, how are we feeling?
I'm feeling fantastic. Been for a nice little stroll, you know, where we've got the weigh-in tomorrow. You know, like I say, I feel absolutely fantastic and raring to go and just looking forward to it.
Good stuff. In terms of the opponent, obviously, late change, step in. Is that problematic for you? And also, were you aware of Shaqon prior to, obviously, the change of opponent?
I wasn't aware of him, no. It's the first time I've seen him, watch a bit of footage. The late replacement doesn't really, you know, cause any problems because we had no footage of Ramos anyway, so we're sort of going in blind, at least with this kid. We know what he's about, we know his style, we know what he's going to bring to the table. We did prepare for any sort of style, really, you know, so we've got all bases covered. I can't see him causing any problems, apart from a tough night's work, you know, is a pressure fight and it comes, and I'm sure over there, you know, at the end of the 12 rounds, so it's going to be an hard 12 rounds, but I think I can look good and box smart.
Okay, so that infers then potentially that he hasn't been stopped before, because you sort of alluded to it there, you're expecting 12 rounds.
I'm not sure if he has been stopped once, he's lost twice and I'm not sure if he's been stopped.
Okay.
But I'm going off a bit of footage what I've seen on Mourinho, and my coach has watched plenty of him. He said he will be there for 12 rounds. Mourinho couldn't stop him. He got a very wide marginal decision, you know, so that we'll hopefully be looking at that, you know, stepping off. I'm looking good in this fight.
Okay, I mean, it's sort of like curious, your career at this moment in time, in the sense of when you get to the lower weights, obviously it seems like there's only a few pounds increments between the kind of junior bantam and bantam and super bantam, whereas obviously as you move up weights, it increases that increment. But obviously you're currently fighting at bantamweight, that's where you've won your two world titles. But I have heard you talking recently about potentially stepping up to super bantam, obviously because that's becoming a bit of a glamour division in the UK. Is it purely because you are the allure of those high profile fights is why?
That's it. It is, yeah, because down at bantamweight there's no names, there's no massive names, you know what I mean? There's Commander, hopefully come through, there's the beat Commander. I want to unify every belt, you know, but if the money's not there and the names are not there, you know, the name's not there, the money's not there. You know, if I move up, you know, after the Commander fight next year, there's Quigg, Frampton, Santa Cruz, big names, big money, you know what I mean, big draws, and that's what it's all about. So, you know, I've got this fight, I've got an hard fight Saturday, touch when I come through that. We have Commander, March, April time. You know, that's still a big act in these two fights, you know, then we'll sit down and we'll take it from there. I might be ready to move up naturally anyway, you know, apart from, you know, the decision of moving up to fight bigger names, you know, but first things first, I get Saturday out of the way, and then can move on to Commander.
And obviously you talk about unifying the titles there. I mean, obviously you've already won the IBF. We all know what happened there, sort of following it, but you've won the IBF. You've got the WBA now, and obviously really the only one that eludes you is the WBC title in terms of the three most recognised belts. So is that kind of your aspiration? Win the WBC, then you can say you've won all three belts at Bantam, move up.
Well, I beat Commander, I've got the WBO as well. I'll target the WBC champion. I ain't fussed about the IBF, it's just Randy Cavallaro, not a massive draw, good undefeated kid. But I've got that belt, you know what I mean? Yeah. I want a belt what I ain't got, and then the WBC would be the last belt. You know, I've racked them all up then. You know, I'm happy I could even, you know, he could retire, you know, if you want in it for money. You know, I'm in it for money as well, you know what I mean? So I'll be looking for bigger fights, but there's plenty of possibilities, you know what I mean? But it puts a bit of pressure on this fight, because it's like any fight, you've got to win this fight, you know. The world title fight, the kid's going to be, you know, motivated and he's going to want to win, so, you know, I'm going to have my hands full.
And obviously, Paul Butler, he recently moved up to Bantam to fight Stuart Hall, but then am I right in saying subsequently he's now moved back to junior bantamweight? Was that a source of frustration to you, because that was a potential UK super fight?
Yeah, well, but I only beat Shuri, do you know what I mean? It would have been a good return, do you know what I mean? Because he had the belt, what I hold. You know, there's no point going over old ground, you know. So I was never too fussed about the fight. Butler beat him, you know, there's no point even going there now. Butler's moved down, obviously he's not ready to move up to bantamweight.
Yeah.
Now I'd move up to super bantam if there were a fight there, I thought I could win and the money were good. And then I'd drop back down, do you know what I mean? Just like he has, you know, you can't blame him for that. You know, but he will be moving back up probably in a few fights.
And did you think, I mean, not asking for any controversial soundbite here, but do you think, I mean, obviously Paul moved up, then he's moved back down. Do you think he didn't fancy the fight against you at bantam?
Maybe, as you know, he might not be ready to move up, and you know, it'd be a tough fight, you know. But I believe, you know, he just wasn't ready to move up. You know when you're ready, you know when you're ready to move up and take on the bigger kid. But it's like me now, I won't move up for a few fights,
yeah.
Unless there's big money or big fight. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You know, so maybe he would have slapped.
Yeah, and obviously you mentioned, you specified a few big names there at Super Bantam. One of the names that wasn't mentioned there was obviously Kid Galahad. Now, in terms of both Yorkshiremen, aren't you?
Yeah.
In different parts of Yorkshire, but you're both Yorkshiremen. I mean, would that be a massive fight in the Super Bantamweight division, do you think? Regionally,
yeah,
especially?
Yeah, regionally, yeah, definitely. It's a big fight anyway, do you know what I mean? But I think he'll have to move on and do a bit of something. You know what I mean? Just to draw it, to make it into a big fight. I think that's his problem with Quigg and Frampton, and that, you know what I mean? He's as good as them, but he doesn't bring the draw like they've done, you know what I mean? They're bringing more to the table sort of thing, so, you know, when he goes and does something, maybe, you know, there'll be a massive fight with any of them champions.
And like you say, you think he's good enough to, so you think ultimately he will go on to reach that level?
I do, yeah. He's Kid Galahad's good, you know what I mean? He's slick. He's just got to go and prove himself, do you know what I mean? He's still building his way up there, he's going to get his chance, and he'll take his chance, you know what I mean? And then that's when you start squaring up with your domestic kids Quigg and your Frampton, do you know what I mean? And make it a big fight.
And without asking you to sort of go on record and make predictions, obviously, you know, everyone's talking about that division, and it sounds like your intention certainly within the next 12-18 months is to be a part of that.
Yeah.
You know, obviously people are looking at Quigg Frampton immediately, and then obviously Kid Galahad when he gets in the mix, and it sounds like you'll probably be in the mix in about 12 months in that division as well. What's your kind of predictions if those guys do face off in the near future? You know, obviously we'll start off with Quigg Frampton. How would you see that one going?
I don't know, they've both been looking impressive in the last fight, you know what I mean? I think it all goes down to, you know, was probably the best camper who turns up on the night, you know, they're both as good as each other.
Yeah.
You know, you just gotta nail it on the night, you know, and have the best preparation. You can have a training camp and you have niggles and injuries, you know what I mean, and they can affect your performance. So whoever nails the training camp and turns up on the night, I think, you know, gets the win.
Yeah. And I wanted to ask, obviously, about your brother as well. Obviously, an impressive performance last time out. It was an impressive display. He operates at Super Bantam, doesn't he? I mean,
yeah.
Presumably, you two are your main sparring partners, or
yeah,
at least one of your main sparring partners. Do you get some of the best work out of your brother?
It's good, I do, yeah. He can dig a bit out of it, you know what I mean? And, you know, it catches me. We have good spars, real good spars, you know. Obviously, I'm good sparring for him.
Yeah.
And he's getting up there now, he's proving his semi, you know, he's beating good kids, beating names, and he's got a European title shot. You know, give it 12 months to 18 months, he'll be knocking on world titles. You know, he's not ready for that big step up yet. You know, we'll put him in with Quigg and Frampton. He's not as ready, you know what I mean? But, you know, he's still be learning his trade. He's unexperienced, you know. He only had 5 amateur fights. He had 5 and won 5. But he's not massively experienced, you know what I mean? So he picks most of his stuff from me. What I tell him, he's been around me for quite a few years, you know, as a pro. So he picks it up that way, the experience. But at least 12 months, he'll be knocking on doors for world titles.
And is that, I mean, like, in terms of obviously, you know, brothers, you're obviously very close as well. It's like, I suppose you can't put into words what it would mean for for both of you to become world champions?
I don't believe he will be a world champion. Yeah. He's got the same drive as me, with the same person. I never thought I was going to be a world champion. No one else did, you know, and I pulled it out of the bag. So why can't he, you know what I mean? I believe I can move up to Super Phantom and beat all of them, and, you know, and he's the same, you know what I mean? He'll jump in with me tomorrow. Yeah. You know, if he believe he'll win, but, you know, there's times, you know, when, you know, you don't fight them kids, and he's not just ready just yet, you know what I mean? The opportunity might come along, maybe it's, you know, in the 8 months or something, you know, I'm sure he'll take it, but it's up to, you know, his management and Dave, or, you know, if they're ready to put him in there, but, you know, he's learning and training, he's getting there.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, obviously, best of luck on Saturday, and looking forward to these sort of UK super fights, you know, in the next couple of years.
Thank you.
Cheers, Jamie.
Cheers.